Doing animatics in Blender isn't something new to me. I did it on Lights Out, I did it on Shazam. But the way I did it was I would draw the 2D characters separately and then put those as textures onto flat planes. It works, but it's cumbersome and hard to adjust and animate. People would tell me to use the grease pencil and draw 2D directly in Blender. I tried it in the past, but it felt very unintuitive and I didn't like how drawing felt. Well, Blender keeps getting better and better, and I recently gave it another shot and watched some in-depth tutorials. Now I've wrapped my head around it and I love it. It's so nice to be able to draw and animate directly in 3D space. It's great for animatics and planning how to shoot a movie. It's much more clear than just standard 2D boards, and it's much faster than creating and posting full-on 3D characters. I can't show you any of the animatics I'm currently working on, so this is an example just for this video. I'm not a great 3D modeler, so I try to find what I need online, either buying it from a site like Kitbash3D or finding models for free. A lot of the times, I only need really low poly basic models. One good source for that is SketchUp models from 3D Warehouse. They're free, but they're not in the right format for Blender, so I use SketchUp Pro to convert. I haven't found a free converter that works, but there might be one out there. Even though the characters are in 2D, you still get some leeway to create coverage by creating different cameras and finding new angles. And you can, of course, draw new frames from any angle you want. You can use sculpt mode to change and edit your characters. You can interpolate motion between keyframes. You have a bunch of filters and so on. One downside of grease pencil objects is that they don't quite integrate like 3D objects. They don't cast shadows and they don't get affected by things like depth of field or motion blur. There are ways to cheat this though, like animating a blur effect, and for depth of field you can add an effect that mimics it pretty accurately. Now, even though grease pencil has come a long way, I still feel it can be a bit unintuitive, especially if you come directly from standard 2D animation software. For example, the colors you use are all materials, so if you want red, you don't just click on red like in Krita or something, you have to create a red material. There is a way to paint with vertex colors instead, but there are benefits to using materials. You can change your red to a different color and everywhere the color is used is updated, but it is a different way of working that you'll have to get used to. And it's always frustrating before you've learned how something works, like when I wanted to turn on onion skins. I turn on onion skin in the overlays, no onion skin. Oh, I have to turn on onion skin for the layer, still no onion skin. Oh, I have to turn on onion skin for the material as well, but still no onion skin. Oh, I'm in the rendered view, I have to be in one of the other views. Once you know this, it's no problem, but to get there, there will be lots of swearing while angrily googling for answers. One of the YouTubers whose tutorials really helped me was this French artist. I'll link to that channel as well as some others in the description. One thing to point out about this tutorial is the way they draw a box here, doing it by hand for each side. Nothing wrong with that approach, that's their style and method, but I just wanted to mention that you can convert geometry to grease pencil. So let's say I want this shape, but as a grease pencil. First, I'll make a duplicate and hide the copy. I'll tell you why in a second. When you convert something to a grease pencil object, all the edges will be drawn, which you might not want. So I'll go in and delete some of these edges before converting. I'll delete the fill layer on this. Instead, I'll unhide my duplicate of the object. I can either leave it like this or convert this to a grease pencil as well. First though, I'll go into edit mode, select everything and press Alt-S to scale things down a tiny bit to avoid things overlapping. For this object, I'll delete the stroke layer. Now I can join these two into one object if I want to and start working on it. You might feel that the lines are way too perfect and mechanical with this method, but if we subdivide the strokes, we can add a noise modifier and vary the thickness and position. You can animate this as well if that's a style you want. Another cool thing I'm using for animatics that doesn't have anything to do with Blender is Google Earth Studio. It's free, but you have to apply for it. I got accepted like a day after I applied. And what you can do with it is animate a camera flying around in actual locations around the world. The whole world isn't in 3D, but a lot of cities are. Here I've rendered out flying over Philadelphia and I've added some fake motion blur on top. The cool thing is that you can also export a camera for After Effects if you want to add things to the shot. This is great for doing establishing shots or planning out helicopter or drone shots or something. Alright, so that's how I currently make animatics. I'm constantly looking for better and most of all faster ways to get ideas out of my head, And this is the best one yet for me.